It's Fran again in the lab at the bench with my annual end of the year nostalgia build project. This one I've been working on for a week or so, although I've been planning it for quite some time. And this is it. I made this sort of scratch built project, nostalgia project, done in the 60s, 70s era kind of scratch build with simple rules. Basically, I only used things that I had in stock in my bins for everything. Everything about this is just stuff that I had lying around in bins, from the power cable, which came from a pile of power cables from University of Pennsylvania, to original old style carbon composite Allen Bradley resistors, which also came from the University of Pennsylvania, to the high voltage metal film polycaps, which all were just in my bins, and even the case, which I bought a few years ago at IKEA. It was one of these things that I saw this glass domed wooden based display thingy at IKEA, and I thought, definitely someday I'm going to make something out of something like that, which it turned out to be perfect for this. So everything about this was completely scratch built just from stuff I had on hand, which made some interesting effects, because I didn't really expect it to be this crazy or to blink this fast. It was supposed to be sort of a kind of a casual kind of a blinky-de-blink thing. It's kind of like, you know, kind of crazy. But that's, again, sort of the random sort of way this works. But anyway, the case is a Hallegia, which came from IKEA, and this worked out perfect for this because it's got the solid wood base. It looks like walnut, but it says on the website it's actually acacia. Hallegia is apparently is Swedish for lovely. It's great. I mean, it certainly is lovely. So yeah, this is basically a neon tree of a network of relaxation oscillators, just a very simple resistor capacitor network. And it runs off of a high voltage full wave rectified DC, and uses these Russian made neon lamps, which I showcased in a previous video about the green neons. Like I said, the rate of blinking is, it's kind of crazy. Some of them are very bright and very short blinking, and some of them are kind of dim. Again, it's, you know, there are some considerations here with the values. I didn't want to go higher with the resistors, but I definitely probably could have gone higher with the capacitor values on some of the legs, especially on the top of the thing. But let me take the top off and you get a better view of what's going on. Okay. All right. Oh, very carefully remove the casing. So yeah, it's all high voltage. So in fact, 165, 166 volts DC. So yeah, I of course signed it, but this turned out to be kind of a beautiful mess. It was much slower when I didn't have as many sections. Some of these are, like this one down here, is strangely dim on the bottom. Some of them on the top are kind of really crazily bright. like this one, I didn't expect this one like going crazy nuts like that. If it would have been a different rules, I probably would have spent more time tweaking the values of the caps and such. Okay, so when I started this build, I began by working on the base of the case. I knew that I was going to want to power it with mains, so I wanted to have a way of stringing the electrical cable into the base without it being too obtrusive, and I didn't want it to be, you know, unattractive. I wanted to be able to put the glass globe over top of it, so I drilled a hole down through, all the way through the base, and then having put that pathway through, I flipped it over, and then just with a chisel, which I sharpened, just sharpened my chisel with a little bit of very, very fine emery paper before I use it, and just put a new edge on it, and just chiseled out a little groove, which will allow the cord to flex through. And after I'd carved out the groove, put a little bit of a bevel on the inside, just with an X-Acto knife, so that the cord would make a nice easy turn. And after I put the cord through it, that'll lay down, allow clearance so that it can lay flat on a table. Pretty easy. I also had to drill some holes for the uprights, which I kind of just figured, again, just kind of just figured, well, it'll be like this and so I just marked out some spots evenly spaced for the kind of configuration I wanted, drilled them out down to, like, I don't know, like 15 or 20 millimeters, and then I cut pieces of this silver-coated copper wire, which I had left over from my Model A Hi-Fi build back in 2000. Again, everything's got to be scrapped, nothing new. So, but yeah, I had to straighten out the wire, cut it to length, and then just using a little bit of just regular carpenter's glue, kind of worked it down into the holes and, you know, set it in place. And after I had had the three, you know, put down in there, glued down in, just left it to dry overnight. And then the next day I straightened out, you know, with just using a square to get the all the uprights as straight and parallel as I could before I started doing the build. And like I said, everything is scratch built. I built the rectifier on the bottom using diodes that I actually got down on Canal Street back in 1999 as part of a haul, early haul. So those were out of my bins. And I even went so far as to put a fuse on this little 3-amp fuse. People said in the past, "Oh, Fran, why don't you put a fuse in that? You're just plugging the mains right into the transformer, right into this." It's like, yeah, it's not something I usually do, but in this case, because there's no transformer, the mains are going right to it. These electrolytics, they're 10 microfarad at 400 volts. It's total overkill. I really probably didn't need anything over like 1 or 2 microfarads, but it's what I had. It's what I had in the bin. So I'm just using them. And I also used a pair of 820K resistors. Again, these are 1-watt carbon composite resistors. The 820K is just there to act as a bleeder to drop down voltage when you turn off the unit. It just bleeds the caps. Well, I got the power supply built. And I've done this before, but the basic calculation, if you want to know what kind of a DC voltage you're going to get in a power supply from an AC voltage, I've got the mains going right into a rectifier, full bridge rectifier. I have this split though, so it's basically a full wave bridge rectifier, only it's split, so you have two rails of plus, you see. And you can do this, but you have to have two different condensers. So I got two positive rails and one negative rail for this project. If you want to figure out what kind of voltage you're going to get, you take the amplitude of the AC voltage times the square root of 2, which is a sinusoidal function. Square root of 2, it's an irrational number. It goes on forever, but if you take the square root of 2, see here, it's 1.41421, it's a blah, 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 it goes on forever. But, you know, 1.414 is more than adequate for just about any kind of calculation. The line voltage, I just took a test. It fluctuates a bit, but currently the RMS AC voltage is 120.4 volts. So take 120.4 volts times 1.414. get 170.2 volts. Okay, so let's turn this on and see what we get. All right, 167.7 volts. Well, wait a second, Fran, that doesn't work with the math. That's not 170 volts. Well, 170 volts is ideal, but in the real world there are losses. You know, diodes, especially silicon diodes, they're not 100% efficient. You have a voltage loss, forward voltage drop with every diode. So for this kind of silicon diode, it's like 0.7 volts. So let's say 0.7 volts times four diodes, it's 2.8 volts. So 170 volts minus 2.8 volts. 167.2 volts. So it's, you know, within a, you know, within a small margin of error, 167 volts. So, but yeah, and I also have, you know, some dropping resistors here to bleed off the caps when I unplug it, which works if I unplug it. Here. Yep. Watch the, that's these 800K bleeding resistors. Dropping voltage down, that way it doesn't stay hot. When I unplug it, it'll, you know, very easily drain those caps so they don't stay hot. But that's the basic idea. If you ever want to calculate a power supply, it's, you know, it's, you take the amplitude of the AC voltage times the square root of 2. And if you calculate in some of your other losses and such as that, you can get the exact number. But as a basic rule of thumb, it's a great quick calculation to figure out what you're going to get for a full-wave rectifier. All right. You know, I spent a lot of time first just assembling the resistors. And people are going to say, Fran, these carbon composite resistors, they really drift in value over time, and you know, they're probably not the value you expect them to be. No, you know, I checked all of them because, you know, I wanted to make sure that the values weren't crazy off. So when I built up the resistors out of combinations of values to try and get somewhere near the values I was shooting for, you know, I did test them to make sure that they were within spec before I would, you know, put them in. And so to make it easier myself, I broke it down to five basic values. I put together 4.5 meg, 2.5 meg, 3 meg combinations, and also I had some 1.5 meg resistors. And I had to build one 5.8 meg to sort of make up the values. All right, here we go. First test, I got the first RC layer. Put the fire to the wire. All right. It's sort of working. This one's a little, one on the right's a little dim. It's sort of working. All right, that cap is charging back and forth. Put that down a little bit. All right, twinkle, twinkle, little neons. All right, that's one level. All right, so now I'm gonna build another level and bring this oscillation down another level with a couple of caps to another set of resistors and lamps, and make a more complex oscillator and work on down the tree. I did it from very important. People are going to say, why are you doing the top first? Well, I'm doing top to the bottom because, you know, with these rails, they're just, you know, a silver, silver wire, silver covered copper wire. I'm doing from the top bottom so that these rails don't get all wonky. I figured if I went from the bottom to the top, this whole thing would gradually twist as I would make little errors in the spacing and such. So by doing the top, it just makes the distance and the sort of spacing of these upper rails even. So I just go down like a stepladder and they should be relatively unwonky. So there you go. All right. And that should bleed out there. It's slowly dimming away. Look at that. As the power goes down and down, down. All right. Success. And the capacitors, too, just using what I have on hand. I had 0.22 mic polypropylene caps, 630 volt polypropylene caps, metal film. and some 250 volt 0.1 mic metal film caps, and which I, the 0.1s I joined with some 0.047s to make up basically a 0.15 mic cap combos. Although in retrospect, I probably should have gone higher than that. I think the capacitor values ended up being, I think, too low. But again, I didn't really have any idea of the, you know, how the lamps were going to work once I got the whole thing built. But after I had the first two levels assembled, I went and decided I would do a test. I made up some 0.15 caps and dropped down to a identical but mirror imaged, running off the negative rails to the positive rails, same values, mirrored on the bottom. I think it's I got a 2.5 and 4.5 meg mirrored, and going again to the negative rail instead of the positive rail. And I got these 0.15 mic caps running down, so looks pretty good. I don't see any, I mean, it looks kind of ugly. It's so wobbly, it's so hard to solder. But I'm really shaky, but doesn't seem like any dry joints, so gonna give it a try. Okay, here we go. Put the fire to the wire again. Ooh, all right. Got some blinking going on here. That's funky. Look at that. It's gotten brighter too. See, these were a little dimmer. They're a little brighter now, so the voltage has increased and the time duration is less. So it's they're blinking at a higher voltage for a shorter interval. It's working. And again, these values are pretty arbitrary. Just going out of what I got in the bins. Your neon tree can vary accordingly to the values you've got lying around. But, you know, if you switch it out, the basic idea, you know, go symmetrical, making a complex astatic oscillator. I'd categorize it as astatic. Yeah, all right. So just got to continue this on down the tree and make a full neon tree. This is going to take a while. Woo. So I'll time compressing the rest of the build, you know, just da-da-da-da-da, doing the same basic configuration of, you know, resistors, capacitors, and treeing them down. I'll draw up a little schematic later on to show you if you really want to build one for yourself. I did this in blocks. It was very tedious work, and the uprights, although using the really thick gauge, you know, silver-coated copper wire was, you know, great for rigidity and stability, it was basically just one big heatsink. So with my Heiko, it just took forever to get that wire hot enough to get solder to stick to it. So I had to redo a lot of joints, because there was a problem with getting cold joints on the big uprights. But but you know, no major problems. I didn't mess anything up. I didn't have any shorts. I didn't have any like bad connections ultimately. So you know, the whole thing pretty much went off without too much of a hitch. I took advantage of the three dimensionality of it, because I wanted to build this because I knew I was going to put a lot of the capacitors and some of the bridging and such on the back side. But I broke up the whole build into, I guess, 4 days, you know, power supply and first, and then I did the upper legs, and then I did the middle in two other sections. I did the case, and then, yeah, okay, so it was like 5 days work total. Okay, well, it's all built. Probably doesn't show up on the camera because there's just so much stuff, loose stuff. It's time to put the fire to the wire. Here we go. Okay. Please don't blow up. No. Ha ha, okay. Here we go. Whew. There we go, yep. It's a shame with HD, it's the aspect ratio is all wrong. But on the bottom here, I got us a low cycle here on the bottom, and it's all feeding up the tree. Yeah, we've got a couple faster blinks in the middle. Some like double blinks, just because the oscillators are all kind of tied over, you know, one to another, cascading them. So the charge and discharge of each level affects another level. And it works! It works! All right, only one thing left to do. One final step. Perfect. It's perfect. Ta-da! Done, done, done. And I mean done. Perfect. Perfect, perfect, perfect. This top layer is kind of really crazy. I thought I'm going to change a value of one capacitor up here on the top with my capacitor substitution box and see what the difference it makes in maybe the whole thing. So let's give that a try. All right, so I got my vintage Heathkit capacitor substitution box hooked up, and yeah, and just before people comment, yes, I built this box in like 1980 or something, and it does have all high voltage polypropylene caps in it, so it's, you know, you can use it with tube stuff. I hooked it up across this 0.22 mic cap on the top that affects the oscillation in these upper four lamps. And I'm going to just add some extra capacitance to it and see what how it changes the oscillation. So 0.15. Oh, it's slowing down a little bit. Okay, I'm going to double the value. Oh, see? They're still blinking just as it hasn't changed the rate of discharge. But it's definitely changed the oscillation. So if I doubled that value, it would be a lot less. It'd be a little less crazy. but you notice that the duration of the blink doesn't change when I change the value here. So go back to 0.22, right? And if I doubled the value, yeah, it's just slowing down. It's slowing down the cycle, but they're still discharging. I think the reason these are so like quickly flashing is that these Russian lamps, they're designed differently than like the kind of neon lamps you're probably used to seeing with the two like poles like inside the lamp. You know, you get these two electrodes surrounded by the gas lamp. There's like this little cup on the bottom here that acts as one side, and then the cup rests inside like a little cylinder. So you've got this cup and cylinder, which makes for a very even illumination, and there's also a lens, see, you know, acts to, you know, magnify it. But I think that these lamps, although they have, you know, the same basic striking voltage, I think they discharge much quicker because the once it ionizes, I think that the amount of conductance or overall resistance in the tube is much, much less than your regular two-prong tube, just because of all that surface area. I think the blinks are very quick because the rate of discharge of the caps is much, much higher than I expected it would be. The way this is arranged, there's no really current limiting between the capacitors and the lamps. So these resistors are really limiting the rate at which the caps charge, but I did not add another layer of resistors to specifically current limit the lamps. They'll just pull as much current as they can, and so again, if the lamps were not as conductive when they were at when the plasma was activated and, you know, and current was flowing, then they'd probably stay on longer. They wouldn't be as brighter, yada, yada. But, you know, your results will vary accordingly. Okay, so what basically are we looking at? So here we go with the schematic, for those of you who are still watching this incredibly long video. I'm redrawing this because my original drawing has too many corrections and I made too many mistakes on it. So, and this is going to be a lot easier to read anyway. But the power supply, again, very simple. I do have a fuse here, but it comes right off the mains. I'm using four 1N5408 rectifier diodes, and these are good for 1,000 volts. Total overkill for this, but again, they were in my bins, so I used them. And the caps too, you know, two different condensers. Make sure you get the polarity right on the electrolytics or you'll release that magic smoke. But yeah, these are 10 microfarad at 400 volts. Total overkill again, but it's what I had. I don't think you really need more than a microfarad to make this pretty stable as far as the voltage goes, because it just really doesn't pull much current at all. So, but yeah, one mic would be fine. One mic at 200 volts would be more than adequate. And I did put bleeders here, these 820K bleeder resistors, which, you know, they do drop down the voltage at a reasonable clip. And I did that mainly for when I was building it, because I knew that I would have to be testing it on and off, and I didn't want to electrocute myself or be soldering to a leg when there's voltage on it. Who knows what that would cause with the HACO. So this is a good representation of the whole tree. The first two rows, this is what I built, and then I just continued it on down with different resistor values and jumping the capacitors to different legs and stuff to make it a little more interesting. But this is the basic idea. Roughly speaking, you're talking about like one resistive value and then, you know, resistive value times two roughly. So it's like, you know, you got, I ended up building up 2.5 megs and 4.5 megs, but it's like roughly like double resistance. You know, your values can vary. I built up a couple of 0.15 microfarad caps and out of piggybacking a 0.1 and a 0.047, but it makes up like a 0.15 mic at like 250 volts. And then I had these big 600 volt polypropylene caps, 0.22s. The neon lamps, again, I didn't put any current limiting. They just, you know, the resistors set the charging rates of the capacitors, and then the lamps in my setup here, they just pull as much current as they want to discharge. Now, you could regulate the rate of blinking and brightness by adding, you know, current limiting resistors to the lamps where they're, you know, attached to the rails. Put current limiting resistors before going to either the negative rail or the positive rail, and you could tweak those values to change the duration of on and also the discharge rate of each lamp individually to get some interesting effects, I would imagine. And of course, as you change the rate of discharge, you know, you're also going to be changing the cycling of the oscillators. So yeah, lots of chances to make it even more interesting. I just wanted really to make this as simple as possible. It took me like a week to put this together. I would have had to have made this a lot bigger if I was going to use all 1 watt carbon composite resistors, if I was going to add current limiting resistors, and I didn't want to put that much time into it. But you can if you want. Okay, here's the rest of it. I think I got all this right. I don't know, I made a lot of little alterations, but I quickly double-checked this. I think this is correct to what I made. But again, there's no rules here. You can put this together any which way you want. Like I said, you can current limit the lamps. You can change where you bring down connections with the vertical capacitors. I did a little bit here, but you can certainly do more than I did and change it up in any one of a myriad ways. Again, aspect ratio is going against us here, but I'll zoom in just so you can see these last legs here. Same theme. It's basically the same structure, just altering whether the lamps are on the negative rail or the positive rail, changing up the resistor values here and there, changing capacitor values, and again, there's no rules here. You can change out the values as long as you have the voltage correct. If you're using, I used all non-polarized caps, so it just makes it a lot easier, and some jumpers and such, but then this is basically it. Interesting too, because people might ask about the symbol for the neons, and they said, well, that's a capacitor. Well, it's interesting that the representation for the neon lamp is, you know, like a capacitor, two plates, right? And then the circle represents an envelope, a glass tube, and then the dot represents gas-filled, so the neon gas-filled tube with two plates, which is what a neon lamp is. So, very interesting. But this is it. You know, again, if you do decide to make one of these for yourself, yeah, be careful. It is mains voltage, and then some. There you go. This was a long one. Well, that's it for this one, and it was only like when I was setting up to like do this final like outro that I realized that this is sort of the complement, the like 60s, 70s complement to my original first end of the year Fran Lab build, which was the Firefly jar, which I did 8 years ago. And so it's still running. It's somewhere in there. You see, yeah, fireflies in there. But this is it's sort of a compliment to that other build. But yeah, thanks for watching. Hopefully, I've edited this down to a shorter length than the week that it took to build it. if you want to build your own, your results will certainly vary. To use different lamps and different values and such. But that's it. Thanks to everyone on Patreon who not only make this video possible, but managed to, by the end of 2020, this f-ing terrible year of 2020, my patrons managed to get my Patreon funding to 100%. In 2020, and that's great. So we're doing really well at Fran Lab, finally paying the bills with the videos, which is pretty amazing. So thank you everyone who supports the channel on the Patreon. Thank you. All right, I'm Fran. I'll be back here again, probably not with something this complicated, something, but equally fun, I guarantee you. Real soon. What I'm doing.
at the bench again. I'm Fran. Do 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 do